that infrastructure more reliable, to make it better, to operate more efficiently. As a supplier, we provide unique technology and innovative solutions around energy efficiency. A lot of our polyurethane type systems, our styrofoam systems, insulate and save a lot of money when it comes to energy efficiency. Of course, Dow Chemical is a big energy consumer. We purchase over $8 billion of oil per year. We consume a lot of power that's generated out of the supply chain. So over the last 20 years, we've invested in $1 billion of energy efficiency savings. And in return for that, we've received $9 billion in return for that energy efficiency in our infrastructure. Also, we provide a number of innovative solutions for purification of water, so improving the safety, the reliability of drinking water, while also providing technology that helps with the efficiency of energy. The second area that we are involved in infrastructure is as an investor. And so to your question, what is it that we look for as an investor in infrastructure? And the first thing that we look for is we look for a national plan that sets out priorities around industries. Because as an investor of petrochemicals, advanced materials, we need to know what the country's priorities are. Because those priorities help us set direction for our investments, whether it's around energy efficiency, water efficiency, electronic materials that we supply into the marketplace. So the national plan is very important. And of course, having a reliable infrastructure as a part of that national plan. And of course, like my colleague was saying, we look for a close collaboration and relationship with the national government and the local governments of that country. So those are the three factors that we look for. And we have a good example. Over the last 20 years in Thailand, we've invested a lot of money in Thailand. In the last 3 years, we've invested $3 billion in Thailand, mainly because of the infrastructure that was built in the early 1980s, and not just the infrastructure, but the power, the utilities, the pipelines that came along with that infrastructure that are critical to our investments. Along with that, Thailand pursued aggressive trade policy, so that trade policy was critical. And of course, having a good labor base in Thailand to make those investments work was important. So Thailand is a good example of where you had a national plan, it was worked on for many years, and we've made investments there. Another example that's more local here in Russia is in Vladimir. And starting about 6 years ago, we started working on a project in Vladimir to invest in our polyurethane technology to provide energy efficiency for oil and gas pipelines, for tanks, for pipes. When you do the reconstruction of the major cities and you want to better insulate the steam pipelines so you don't lose as much energy out of those pipelines, we have technology that we invested in our joint venture in Vladimir to do that. So Dow Ezolon has been operating now for 5 years in Russia. It's been very successful. And in that investment, we had good cooperation from the regional government, from the local government of Vladimir. And of course, we have a great partner. And I would say that's the other critical aspect of investing, is finding good partnerships, partners that you know, that you can trust, and that you can invest with. So those are the things that we look for. And like I say, infrastructure creates a lot of opportunity, creates a lot of jobs. And in this emerging part of the world, I think it provides a much bigger opportunity than you have in the developed parts of the world like the US or Western Europe. So I think the time has never been better to have an APEC conference here in Russia because of the opportunities that I'm sure we'll hear more about from my colleagues here on the panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Pat, so much. So let's move to perspective of a large corporation which is hugely involved in natural resources. Mr. Deripaska, for your businesses, what are the costs of underdeveloped infrastructure? And maybe for the whole region.
Cost is clear. Less profit and more time. But I'd like to present, you know, our case, which we started more than 10 years ago. we decided to construct in partnership with Russian state hydro company, power plant, 3.7 gigawatt capacity, and smelter, 700,000 ton. It was quite complex decision. That's why I absolutely agree with my colleagues that national plan, those days it wasn't national plan, it was a decision to create investment fund which will support some project, you know, in terms of infrastructure development, and also there was idea about creation of Vneshkonom Bank, who will later will come and help to raise financing in case it would be difficult for some part of the project. But I can tell you, you know, since 10 years, you know, we, this year, we complete first phase of construction. We have first power delivered in our power project, and next year we will deliver metal. What we learn? First of all, infrastructure. You need to build roads, railway roads, bridges. You know, you need to build, you know, power connections. You need to build social infrastructure, and everything should be well planned. You know, from the beginning, you need to synchronize development with discussion on territory. You need to have support of the people, because, you know, it's your people, you know, who would later, you know, work, you know, with you. And of course, you know, it's very important. It should be in a special arrangement with the banks and financial institutions. What I do believe would be next step, you know, since we have few projects which already, you know, started, and some of them successfully complete in Siberia. And I think we had this new ministry for development of Eastern Siberia and Russian Far East. You know, I strongly believe that there should be created a corporation which will support, you know, some of the project, because not all of the project, you know, could be done from the greenfield without, you know, proper state partner. And then, you know, we already, you know, heard many announcements about infrastructure. Russian railway should be ramped up almost three times on the Far East. You know, port facility upgrade. It's important to decide tariff, especially for the new project, for new greenfield project, to fix tariffs, you know, on arrangement for, you know, 10, 12 years. It's important to define access to resources. We have we already, you know, had successful story in Russia when people came and developed, and we have a lot of stories when people, you know, were coming, buy a license, sit on this license, trade this license, you know, and in reality produce, you know, almost nothing. You know, as I said, we need to have a proper custom regime for Eastern Siberia and the Far East, and of course we need to, you know, create a proper incentive program to bring more qualified workforce here and train workforce which, you know, should be retrained. And it's a lot of investment. And of course, it's you can't do everything overnight. And that's why I totally agree that we need to have a plan, and we need to have an understanding, you know, what at stages we can deliver and how much money we can raise. One more issue which I think important, you know, Siberia is a unique region. And for sustainable growth in Asia, you know, you don't need just resources. You don't need just market. You need to have agriculture product, you need to have water, and Siberia is a unique platform to provide all these resources. That's why development of the new project, of course, should be implemented with the highest environmental standard in terms of how efficient would be, you know, on impact for on environment. And I think it's important to, you know, to understand that our partners, it's not just our neighbors, which are very important, you know, and of course, you know, our biggest trade partner in China, but also I think in Siberia, able to provide, you know, sustainable support for the growth in the whole Asia. And that's why I think it's important, you know, to bring as much as possible. And infrastructure, it's not just pipes and roads, but also airports, hotel, you know, proper education in the centers, and we've seen in a few countries which develop, like Japan or China, they develop, you know, their national center to help, you know, to study languages and increase exchange, you know, between people of the country. I think this is important, but we shouldn't expect that everything will happen overnight. We're on a long way, and we have to be patient, you know, to do it.
All right, so national plan again. Mr. Yang, I think that for countries like South Korea, cross-border use of infrastructure is critical. So what can be done in this respect on the APEC platform, and how important is it? Or can we just stand by a national plan for infrastructure and it will solve all the problems?
Oh, thank you. Infrastructure bottlenecks are extensive globally. Solution to that is to build a new infrastructure, but that requires time, huge sums of money, and know-how how to build it. So the alternative solution may be sharing of existing infrastructure or plan together with an idea of getting synergy. And let me illustrate some of the cases that that the mutual cooperation is important. First one is gas. I mean the coal gas, which is the Korean version of Gazprom, imports 35 million tons of LNG annually. We are shipping from Qatar, Yemen, Oman, crossing the Indian Ocean and Southeast Asian Sea and turning around the China and coming to Peninsula. We are importing LNG from Australia crossing the Pacific Ocean. But if we have gas pipeline connecting Russia and North Korea and South Korea, pipeline gas is cheaper and safer and handy to use. So Korean beneficiary, Korea would be the beneficiary, and North Korea would be the beneficiary, and Russia would be the beneficiary. Second example that I might bring up is the airport. You might be proud of the new airport built here. I was impressed with the architecture there. But if you come to an immigration checkpoint, that becomes a snail line, very slow. But on the other hand, South Korean Seoul Incheon Airport is so efficient and so fast, it takes only seconds to be cleared. So if you hook up the computer system with the Russian Vladivostok Airport, then you can have the magic wand to have an efficient clearance process.
We that all would avoid lots of troubles.
Another solution to that. And we had a very unusual hot summer in the past summer, with the temperature reaching 38 to 40 degrees Celsius. And so air conditioner operation was high and the demand for electricity was extraordinary. The safety margin of power generation was at risk, and we called it power crisis. But if we have the kind of system to share electricity power generation with Russia, I think it could be done very easily by connecting the grid, the smart grid. Then Korean consumers could have been better off using extra power generation in Russia. Another example might be the ports. I mean, Vanino project, Chairman Deripaska is contemplating on expanding the port. They may expand the terminal for alumina and the grain exports. And if the railway system between South and North Korea and Trans-Siberian rails are connected together, Chairman Deripaska could utilize Busan as a kind of alternative port to be used. I mean, Busan may be a very efficient port to be alternatively used. And I think in the summer, port is not freezing in Busan, so I think that is an advantage. So all kinds of alliance and co-sharing of infrastructure is very important in the sense that we may save time, we may minimize the duplication of infrastructure and so on. And let me have a primary school mathematics together. South Korea is a small country with only 90,000 square kilometers, but its population is 50 million. And per capita income is about more than $20,000. That becomes more than $1 trillion. Even though it is a small country, it has a big market, And I think Russia should explore the situation there, and we have to have a better arrangement for extra cooperation for sharing the infrastructure together. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Oleg, so a very important topic close to your job was raised about integrating the grids in Northeast Asia. So how viable is this project in your point of view? And what could be the mechanism of delivering that?
Thank you very much for bringing up this discussion issue. In fact, everyone wants infrastructure, especially power supply infrastructure, should be affordable, accessible, and growing fast. And these are demands that can create conflicts. And, to overcome the conflicts, we need a good team. And I see that we have a team at the federal level in Russia, and we have good examples on how networks develop very swiftly, and a good climate is created in terms of operators to customers relations. We used to have 42 closed power centers. Now we have only half of them, and we are going to release more centers for better connections, and average cost of connection was formerly 78 million, and today it's only 18 million rubles. At the regional level, in the near future, we'll be working on putting up teams together that would be ahead of the curve, so to say, in development of infrastructure. For the Far East, we are faced with unique opportunities, and I think we have here a good gathering of friends. This is how I treat you. Well, this is an excellent area for development because the Far East is not suffering from some problems that came with the bad legacy from the former periods. I am very grateful to my colleague for being able to have very proactive contacts from his republic with the Chinese Republic, and we come together and discuss energy supply problems jointly. I talked in last August with Mr. Liu from the energy company, and we agreed to create the so-called power bridges for shipping energy over long distances with minimum losses. An advance of technology presented us with new opportunities, and we believe that the Far East would be an ideal place to launch such pilot program. We have several versions of how to go ahead, a huge circle that would embrace China and other republics, but we could have small arrangements for neighboring countries. This year, by the way, Primorsky Krai will become part of our coverage, and this area will get a new boost for production development and energy supply.
Якутия будет полноценным участником энергосистемы страны.
In the next 2 years, Якутия will be a full member in this project, and such huge projects, I'm sure the future of the power systems is the integration with the neighboring countries. We are already participating with 11 countries, and of course, well, mainly they are the former Soviet republics, but there is Finland, China, and Mongolia, and I'm convinced that new technology and opportunities will be developed. The main thing is not even in financing, but in correct in good planning, good long-term planning, and we have a methodology of regulating this project, and we started using it, and banks and investors in our country trust us. The main thing is for these plans to be correct, not to change them drastically so that they comply with the programs of social development of the regions, and that the customer should be held responsible as well. We are talking about legal networks. Of course, we'll be building clever networks, intellectual networks, but intellectual networks require a sensible user who knows what his future load is and how they're going to use this electroenergy sensibly. And I'm sure that the main topic of this summit is infrastructure, electricity grids, and for instance, by the airport, they're building a plant by Hyundai, and it's a super modern plant with the newest technology with South Korea, and it will be taking part, and this is a collateral that these projects will take place. Thank you for all the
planning, more coordination. Ziyavudin, all the projects we mentioned will really need huge amounts of capital. At the same time, 3 years ago, we entered into the period of very vulnerable markets, and many governments have to cut their budgets, and this is extremely the case here in Russia. So I know that you were chairing APEC this year, and one of the major topics was discussion of how to increase the potential of existing infrastructure and increase the efficiency of usage in existing infrastructure. So could you brief us on that?
Alexander, спасибо.
Thank you, Alexander. One of the main priorities of the Russian government was to resolve the logistic chain and the energy systems problems, and we had some success with our colleagues on APEC. And I'd like to say that the financial results, and one of the results was that we determined the priorities within the framework, which are the most topical ones as far as hard infrastructure is concerned. As far as the soft infrastructure is concerned, we've already determined and defined a set of standards. Today we signed signed an agreement with GS1, and we became partners and GLONASS, and all these simple mechanisms together with a single window approach will allow us to use to our advantage the particular features of the Russian economy, and the sum we are looking at, it's about $1 trillion, and it's only 1%, which is Russia's share in this project, but one of the elements and criteria of efficiency is that that the structure of costs on average in Russian, the share of transport is about 15% instead of 7%, which is typical for developed countries. There are two fundamental problems. One of them is the hard infrastructure, and as you know, 80% of the flow of commodities is transported by railways. It's practically a monopoly, and there are bottlenecks, and there are problems, approaches to ports, and we have this problem which involves about $150 million. So this is an opportunity to improve the infrastructure around ports, which means that we would get $150 million more. The second problem is a problem of service. There is no single window. About 80 documents should be filled in for such a primitive procedure as clearing the customs. And as we know, the single window allows to make this procedure simple. It takes about 13 days to clear the customs now, which is not acceptable. And because, as you've already heard, that it takes much less time to load the consignment and then ship it, and then it takes days and days to get the clearance of it. And we have two big projects. One is a Trans-Siberian Railway, and the other one is the North Sea Route. North Sea Route will allow, instead of 34 days for shipping a container, to bring it down to about 20 days. And this is Tixi, Dixi, Dudinka, and that's on the route. As far as the Trans-Siberian Railway, it will allow to reduce the 32 traditional days down to 8-9 days, and this is a significant improvement, optimization.
And the interests here coincide of all parties, so we decided with our colleague to implement GS1 next year, and the concept of single window and promoted as the best practices throughout Asia-Pacific region. It will allow Russia by 1220 to increase flow of containers from 200,000 to over 1,200,000. So on average, due to improved operation, one container will cover not 700 kilometers, but rather 1,500 kilometers. I should also point out that we have good success stories for huge global infrastructure projects like FSK. Projects. FSK is very proactive in infrastructure in this area. And Transneft, this company, is working on three fundamental problems: geographic diversification, increasing accessibility, and a possibility to increase capacity, to build up capacity. And the oil workers have a chance to go east, to go west, and this is a part of solution of Russian infrastructure programs.
We have about 10 minutes left. I would like to open the floor for your questions. So please raise your hands, those who want to ask this, use this opportunity. We have girls behind with the mics, probably guys also. So, any questions? No questions. Now you know everything about infrastructure and what we need to do, joint plan. Okay, I would have some questions. We were talking a lot about national planning, but also there is a problem of duplication of infrastructure. Let's talk about Trans-Siberian Railway. Chinese have included in their five-year national plan upgrade of the railway system from Tianjin to Kazakhstan border, and that could be probably another way to transport goods and another channel for transit. So what do you think, how should we coordinate these stories? Is there any sort of mechanism, maybe in APEC, which could avoid this duplication? Because obviously the major channel right now is Suez Channel for transporting goods. Transit takes just 1%, and two railway corridors, one will definitely generate losses. So Pat, what do you think about that? Is there any way to coordinate?
I'm certainly no expert in these rail lines that are being built. I think some of my colleagues have probably better insights into this, but I think when you go back to the national plan and how you coordinate that with the investors in these rail lines, I think that's where the discussion has to start. And if you don't start soon enough to understand which rail line is going to be the most competitive and will serve the best interests of the people traveling on that line, then you've missed the opportunity. It will be too late. So the key is to have those types of discussions that are consistent with a national plan, in this case, between Russia and China. But the investors have to be brought in early to have these discussions.
So business should be at the table to discuss these issues?
Absolutely.
Okay. Then, Oleg, are you ready to transport your aluminium, as Dr. Yan suggested, using the territory of North Korea? What about political risks and geopolitics and infrastructure? Because some ideas might be reasonable for businesses, but some, for example, ports, which are not needed for businesses, are very relevant in terms of national security.
Why not? It depends upon tariff time and what would be custom clearance condition. But I think you can't solve problem without exposure. And few problems already was mentioned. It's time of custom clearance, speed of the trains, logistic in port, the whole organization of movement of cargo trains in Russia, and tariffs. Everything should be addressed, and I think we can be as attractive as Suez way, and we can be as competitive as any container ship aboard. And it just needs time and efforts. But as far as we understand, railway addressing this issue, new port capacity, there is new investors in the private business take a lead in logistics, and it will be done.
Okay. Ziyavudin, there is also a big talk when we talk about hardware and infrastructure that the state should support the companies to develop it, not only by direct financing, by making easier the tax system and providing some different specific regimes and so on. Do you think it's needed here in this region, for example, for the Russian infrastructure building in the Far East?
As I've already said, all these factors are connected, and on the one hand, we should increase the capacity of Russian railways. On the other hand, at the same time, we should improve the railways, build new stations for sorting the commodities, and we should think better where we can optimize and improve the efficiency and where we should build new things. And for instance, in Vladivostok, in the port, the capacity is about 6 billion, and we, of course, need to increase the capacity of Russian ports in the Soviet times and after the Soviet era in the 1990s. Commodities flowing past Russian ports have increased the capacity greatly because in the Soviet times there was only one person who was shipping the cargo and one person who was receiving it. And at the moment we have lots and lots of participants in this process. And of course the infrastructure needs improving. As far as the soft infrastructure is concerned, we need a single window and RFID and the code, and these three components give us the opportunity to achieve the functional growth of commodity flows. And I think one of the advantages in Russia are transits, and we can't lose that.
Something for these projects, you think that you can implement them just by making the existing infrastructure more efficient? Do I get your sense?
Well, if we are talking about tariffs, the tariff component, there are some kinds of commodities which are transported to Far East, but it's not feasible and not sensible, for instance, grains. And we should use the opportunities given to us by the World Trade Organization, the amber basket, the yellow basket, because it costs to transport as much, it costs as much to transport a basket of grain from Altai to Europe. And for instance, the Altai Grain Union has good perspectives, and we need a more flexible approach. We should look at tariffs then. Thank you.
Questions from the audience. Okay, there is one. Please give the mic to the lady in green.
Добрый день, если можно.
I'd like to ask Oleg Vladimirovich, it's always interesting to speak about examples and not theory. It's not a secret that your production is going through rough times because of strikes. And what is your strategy about these plants? You'll probably tell us about Bogoslovsky. How are you going to solve the problem with those you've sacked? And are you not worried about these strikes? And of course, it's interesting to know your opinion about the court in London. Do you think it's a precedent? And what do you think about your case? Thank you.
I can reply half of the internet, but better ask Google, as it says in Russia. Russia, it's not just slogan, become competitive. Russia, we need to do a lot of efforts to be competitive. And we have all facilities. There is no opportunity to keep them alive. You know, we need to change them. We know we need to build new in a place where it's more efficient, where our customer located, where we can, you know, use resources on long term, on clear tariff arrangement. And we're definitely doing this, and we built. For the all facilities, it's a complex solution. And you know, as much as I can do, I'm trying to do, you know, to support these facilities. But there is an opportunity for, you know, me, for the local government, you know, for our companies and for federal government to work together. And I'm sure this issue which was raised, you know, we can solve. But again, in Russia, we're just in the beginning. And of course, we rest a lot of time on this cushion from oil and gas. And at the moment, you know, we see challenging situation with the shale gas, and we have a lot of new development which will change industrial, you know, processes, and we need to be competitive, and we shouldn't stop, you know this fight for competition, you know, at any moment.
So that was not very optimistic, but I have to wrap up the session because President might be approaching, and let's hope he. Oh, there is one. Do we have still time for one last question? No. We absolutely no, right? Okay, sorry guys. So we have to wrap up the session. Thank you very much for your attention. I think that you go back and have some food for thought. And especially those people in the government, because I think that forums like these and panels like these are very crucial for you decision maker to listen to the concerns of the business people, because these are people who generate value, who generate growth, who pay taxes, who create jobs. Thank you so much.